Something that's not new, but there is a theory gaining force where the people are saying that God, or the idea of God, is a man-made conception. They are saying that God was created by men. And I will answer with another physicist. He said if God was created by men, he could not be God, then man would be God. But the Son says, no, God is not created by men. He is who He says that He is. That's all. Amen. So let's close our eyes. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your blessing, for your care, because you brought us here today. And here we are, Lord, humbly to worship you. Please open our hearts and minds as we listen to your word. May the Holy Spirit touch our hearts. Stay with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We want to welcome everyone that's here today and those who are watching us from home. Welcome everyone. As I was thinking to come here today, and yes, always takes quite a while to decide what to speak, and but for the last at least 3 years, for those who hear me, it's almost like the same message, because I have a urgency to talk about Jesus Christ coming soon. I will tell you this: when I just came to, that always for me was stuck in my head. I will say this way. So when Jesus gave all the explanation that people were asking for, he ends with this: I tell you, he will see that they get justice quickly. However, this is the part that I want to read with you. When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? Remember, who is saying that is Jesus Christ himself.
Peter.
And let's say if Jesus Christ would talk about 2021, right? 2021, And he would say, okay, October 23rd, 2021, Newington. When the Son of Man comes to Newington, will he find faith? And sometimes we take this and what does it mean? No, I don't have the perfect answer now. I don't. But Jesus Christ, he knows everything. He knows everything about everything, basically. And he is pointing out here a very intriguing question, because he's making a question to the people. And actually, who was listening to him that time? Basically, the apostles, people around him who said, the people who said they believe in God. He didn't say for the outcast, he didn't say to the Gentiles, he didn't say to the secular people, but he was talking with his close people that supposedly they believe in God. And he said to them, so listen, when the Son of Man, myself, when I come, will I find faith? I wanted to consider a couple things with you today, and the type of my sermon, let's say this way, it's the beginning of the end. That's what I titled it, I decided to write. And I will leave with you the question, do you think 2021 is the beginning of the end? No, just think, don't answer, but think about it. And why I say that yesterday was, let's see, let's bring the memory, that's the quiz. Yesterday was October 22nd, right? What does it come to mind, October 22nd? Anybody knows?
Great disappointment.
What? Disappointment of what?
Second coming.
See, the people are expecting the second coming. 2 weeks ago, we visited a church in Vermont. I forgot this city. And as we are talking with the pastor over there, he told us that was like the second church, if I'm not mistaken, who started keeping the Sabbath. It was 1865 or 66. This church was the 62. Thank you. My conscience is talking to me that 62. When they built this church, and as we went to history, it's unbelievable. I will not tell you the whole history about this church, but the pastor said, you know, this place here, this church they keep there, they were so faithful in 1800s that basically all that, the part or the village, everybody was Adventist. They had 150 members on this place. They had a school there. And he was telling even the story, the founders of the church, there was somebody who didn't believe in the spirit of prophecy until he saw with his own eyes. We went to the back of this place and he showed us the graveyard where the pioneers, they are there, whole family is there. And every year when it comes October 22nd, it is in my heart, I remember this thing. So he was showing us the graveyard, pastor. So you see these people, they die in the hope, in expectation. And they believe that it would come October 22nd, 1844. So Jesus Christ didn't come, but he didn't give up the hope. But many people, they left. So as I was saying, when I was 10 years old, I said, okay, Jesus Christ is coming in my days. But what changed from 1844, when I was 10, and now 2020? What did it change? I never saw people live in fear like now. People are scared, incredibly scared. That's why, you know, I will have this disease. Sometimes it's kind of funny. My wife and I, we were in a place in the street a couple months ago. In the street. And we sometimes we don't pay attention. And my wife sneezes. What do you think happened to people? Because it's a crowded place. Do you know what happened? One man almost fall to get away from us. And other people, they start going a little farther. Because just somebody sneezes in the street. We are living in fear. I don't watch too much the news, but sometimes I'm listening to some people, they are talking. And I heard as a prophecy before, but I never expect to actually hear with my ears. Secular people, afraid of what is in the world, and they are saying, we don't know what to do. We don't know what to do. There is a famous doctor, or I don't know, they call him scientist in the US. This person changes his mind every couple of months to give an explanation to what's going on. Supposedly, he's the genius. Supposedly, he should be the best mind in this country, considering another country, one of the greatest, you know, that know what he's doing. But he changed his mind every 2-3 months. Oh no, I didn't have enough information. Now it's this one. So, and people are following that way. But when they follow that way, got wrong. Say, oh no, it's now it's this information. Would you trust? Who would you trust? We have the written word of God, where Jesus said that this thing must happen in the future, right? Why should we ask somebody else? I want to consider to you a story that's in Exodus 12, chapter 1, and so on. Exodus chapter 12, verses 1 and so on. So here, I'd like to apply a couple of these verses to our days, okay? We know the situation before the chapter 12. So we had the Israelites were in Egypt, came a plague on the place because God said to Moses, hey, I will send it. Something really bad to Egypt, and they will let you go. They will let you leave from the country. However, Moses realized probably they didn't know how long it would take or how many plagues would fall on the country. And at this point, 9 plagues happened to pass in Egypt. And sometimes we are very quickly to judge them. If we were there, okay, came in the first plague, the king, the pharaoh said, no, you're not going. Came in the second, no, you're not leaving. Came in the third, you're not leaving. Would you be keep going, waiting for God's deliverance? Or you get say, hey, why is it taking so long? Remember what I say? When I went to the graveyard, I saw those people there, those pioneers, they were expecting Jesus Christ when? 2021, 2025, 30 or 40? No. 1844. That was the time. And Jesus Christ didn't come. Some lost their faith, but some kept going saying, hey, it's something that we missed. It's something that we missed. Now here, the Israelites, they face the same thing, face the same waiting, let's say this way. I would say that we as the religious people, we face too. Came the first, the second, third, 9 plagues in absolutely nothing. There was no change in the king's and the pharaoh mind. Nothing changed. Their burden didn't it was not loosed. They still suffering for their oppression. They were still slaves there. But then God said to Moses, now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, listen to this. This month shall be your beginning of month, and it shall be the first month of the year for you. When this happened, when they left Egypt, when they settled down in Canaan, before they left Egypt, before even the king said to them, you may leave. The nine times, remember, nine times before the king deceived them, they said, I let you go, and they said, no, you are not going. For nine times, Pharaoh said, no. And here's God to say to Moses, remember, mark this day in your calendar. Today will be your beginning, or first month of the year. Today will be your first year. Wait a minute. What are you talking about? Yes, this will be the freedom day. This will be a freedom day. And this will start your calendar of your freedom. You need to celebrate it today. But we are still where? In Egypt. We are still in the slavery. We are still inside this land. They didn't let us go yet. Like I said, today, this very night, what would you do if you listen to God and say, hey, I want to tell you this. This is the beginning. This time that we're living now is the beginning of the end. You must start putting your calendar, do some preparations, because very soon we will go to the promised land. We will go to the promised land. So as God gives instruction to Moses, what they should do, we know about the lamb, we know about what to do with the lamb. God says something very important to them. When we go to verse 11, you know all the verses before talking about the preparation of the lamb, what they should do. But look what says in the verse 11. And thus you shall eat with your belt and on your waist. One thing that I found very interesting when I just came to America, when I saw people driving a car and eating. And I said, why these people driving and eating? This is making no sense. I come to from a country where to eat, you must sit at the table. That's it, you go sit and you eat. You don't drive a car to eat. Until a couple weeks later that I was here, I found myself doing the same because I needed to rush to another place that I have no time to sit and eat. So I must be ready for the next appointment. So here's Joe driving and eating. And what does it mean here when it says, you shall eat with the belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, your staff on your hand. Why they needed to eat that way? Because they need to leave. They needed to move quickly. Remember, there was no word from the king that they would leave. There was no word. It was just God saved Moses. And so you shall eat in the haste. Hurry. It is the Lord's Passover. So this was the promise from God. So here we have, and then when we go after this, when God gives this instruction, then finally God said to Moses, listen Moses, this very night, at the midnight, I will strike down the firstborn of Egypt, that's the plague number 10. And exactly midnight, the king will call you and you must leave. Why they should trust God that for nine times? But God has an interesting way to do things. He has his own time. Today we comment in the lesson that sometimes God will say to you, no, sometimes we ask God, we want our way, we want what we want in our time. And God, he has his own absolute time. Own time. And here, what God says to Moses, what they have to do, he explains what's going to happen. So, and we have basically here 5 points. One would be the 10th plague, you know, the death of the firstborn. Then the number two, when the people leave, we will not read all the verses, but when the people leave, okay, they didn't immediately went to the promised land. Sometimes we think that come to God, you know, everything will be perfect and fine, which is not. All of us here, we have suffered loss or we have experienced at least problems. But the for the Israelites here, it was a matter of faith. Immediately, they didn't reach a promised land, but that was the time for them to leave. And when they left Egypt, the next, the point number two, what happened? They came in front a Red Sea and the back Egyptian army and said, now what? It's a very difficult time, right? So we cannot swim the ocean and we cannot find the army. What we will do? Some people, what they say, it would be better to perish. Oh, let's go back. Let's go back. However, we know the story, what happened. God opened the Red Sea, they cross over, Egyptian army perish, and we think, okay, we have 12 miracles already so far. You know? Probably we're all set, we're good to go. Let's go. And not yet. When they start walking, they were supposed to 2 years reach what they did, reach the promised land. Only 2 years. What happened then? So no, it's too difficult. No, we can't. It's too much. Let's go back to the civilization. Let's go back to the civilization. That's what they did. And God said, you know what? I need to teach you a lesson. My purpose will work even if you don't want to participate. Do you ever heard this expression before? We will be used by God even if sometimes we don't want to, but we will not participate in the reward. And here's in this, God say, I will teach a lesson. What was the lesson? 40 years in the desert. Today, Maxine mentioned, for those who were here in the beginning, how many people do you think you perished in the desert in 40 years? The Bible says the whole generation who did not believe. The whole generation. It's a lot of people. Now, if we think about faith, remember the first verse? We talk about faith. How many people actually entered in the promised land who were adult when they left Egypt? How many? Wow, can you imagine? Two people from the adult generation entered the promised land. And even if the whole Israelite had perished in the desert, would God fulfill his promise with these two people? Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Because the word of God will not fail. Amen. And here we stop a little bit, brothers and sisters. How many people will meet Christ, will be ready to meet Jesus Christ when he comes? So, we are walking now in the wilderness, I believe. We are walking because it's a lack of stuff, you know. We have a problem with supplies, or we have health issues. We don't know the future, what the future presents to us. We are kind of in a cloud. We cannot see ahead. I know that I'm repeating myself sometimes, but remember last year on March when they came the notice about the news about the virus, they say about 3 months tops. 4 months and everything will be like before. We are in October 2021, going to 2022. Can anybody make a provision now to say, hey, two months? Who give me three? Maybe five? Six? We can rely only on God. So he healed the people in the desert for years. Because they don't believe, but that generation that who did not believe, they perished. Two guys, they believe it, and they entered. And I like one man, especially Caleb, his expression say, hey, you know, I was 45 years old when we left Egypt. I was 45. Now I'm 85. And I'm strong, I'm good to go. And see, what you want? I want a mountain. Which mountain? That one, where there is a fortress on the top, in the fortress, full of giants. That I want. 85 years old. That place that I want. And Joshua say, go on, man. You get it. Did he get it? Absolutely. Absolutely. And here, the last, point number four, when they conquered, finally, they came to Canaan, they conquered the land. And the point number five, finally, they settled down over there. What does it say to us? You know, I believe the Bible, it was written for our instruction. And I also believe that the things that happened in the past will happen in the future. There was just a glimpse. God was talking about one people, one nation, a group of people that he would take and bring the promised land. It doesn't matter what. Now we are living the same situation, brothers and sisters, where we have no clue what's going to happen next. However, God said, I will bring you to the promised land. We will pass to the wilderness. In the wilderness, sometimes we will face lack of something. Maybe we have a problem with health or food or whatever it will be. Some people are threatened now in our country that they can lose their jobs. Why? Because they needed to follow the land rules, regulations or whatever in place. They say, hey, if you don't do this, you're going to lose your job. And the first thing that comes to mind when you lose your job, so how I buy food for my kids, how I will live. Well, wait a minute, who promised you that we will give you the bread and water will be certain? I remember one man when he came to he became a Christian, and I knew this man. And he had like five kids, and they say, well, how, what are you gonna do now? Because in those days, my generation time was difficult to keep the Sabbath, to find a job that could keep the Sabbath. And one day the elder met him in the street and say, how are you doing? How are you holding on? As you know, I read the Bible that God will give water and bread if we would be faithful. And guess what? He gave me juice and the bread. I have something even to put on the top of the bread. He was so simple, this man, the way that he talks. And I took to heart and I said, I don't want to complain. I can't. Because it God promised. So let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 3, 1 to 5. And there is a description of 2020, 2021. I found the description there. 2 Timothy chapter 3, 1 to 5 says, but mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, no lovers of good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power, having nothing to do with such people. Where do you see this? Try and watch and see what's going on. I don't want to give the details, but I was in shock what I heard yesterday in the news. Something happened. I will not give you details. You may search later on, but something happened in one school in Virginia. And it was so bad. It was terrible what happened there with the kids. And for my surprise, instead the punishment for the perpetrator, for the person that did what not supposed to do, they jailed the father of the child that was that suffered the harm. Because the father was talking too loud when he was crying because of what happened with his child. And I found out that the law enforcement was called on the father, not on the criminal. Wow. You see, this picture, it's not, something is not right in the picture. Something's not right in the picture. But here we are in 2021. When we look around, what do we see it? What do we see it? You see, let's go to Matthew chapter 24. Another description of what's going to happen at the end. Matthew chapter 24, verse 10, and so on. We're going to read a couple of them. At that time, many will turn away from the faith. Many will turn away from the faith. Who is talking here? Jesus Christ. He's talking about the future. He's talking about our time. Because we never saw before, at least, I don't remember, where you have the difficulties with government mandates for you to do something that sometimes, I believe always in free conscience, you can supposedly worship as you please or do what you want. But what about when it comes to mandates? Now you need to do this or you get fired. And it's not just this, but people talking with each other, like accusing them, and say, you want to do this, or you don't want to do this because you don't care about others. Also, I read, say, hey, God was created by men. Men just say, okay, I will make a God. And here Jesus saying, men will turn away from, because difficult times we're facing. But do you think this is the, how say, is the top? Do you think this is the worst time? Yeah. Or, according to God's word, worst time will come. What about when there will come a disease that will no be prescription for it? There will be no quarantine. There will be no vaccine. Do you know what I'm talking about? The seven last plagues. What are you gonna do about it? Say, let's call the scientists and hey, what should we do? Trust me, they will come to some conclusion. You know what's the best conclusion that they will come according to the Bible in those days when the seventh plague will come? Hey, there is a people who does not follow the rule. What these people do? They worship on Sabbath. They have their own way of living. So now if we eliminate these people, then we'll be all sad. Am I creating this? No, it's in the Bible. It's in the Bible. When the last plagues will come, somebody will be blamed for. And who will be blamed? Those who do not follow those specific rules. And know why? Because it will be exactly those who will not suffer the plagues. Right now we don't have yet the last plagues. You know why? Because we have people from our middle that are suffering with this illness, this disease. People are perishing, people are dying. I believe some people right now, just God is calling, because some people will not be able to face what is about to come. I don't know about us. I don't know if I'll be able to face. I like what Jack pointed in the morning. When you know the difficulty comes, am I ready to die for Christ? And this is the time that Jesus is saying that it's coming. Verse 11, Matthew 24 says, "And many false prophets will appear and deceive how many people?
Many,
many people. Many people. They will come with ideas, solution." Verse 12, "Because of the increase of wickedness, the love," we are talking about love in the morning, in the class, "the love of most will grow cold." Will grow cold. "The one, however," verse 13, "but the one who stands firm to the end will reach the promised land." It doesn't matter your age. Is it 40 or 85? Like Caleb, we'll reach the promised land. We'll reach there. Even in the middle of difficulties, I want to do another parenthesis here in the verse 14. "And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to how many people? All nations. And then they will, then the end will come." We have wonderful experiences about books. We're distributing books like, I tell you, never ever before in my life I expect that we will be able to do it. But you know what I found more fascinating? I come people to my office today. I had two clients. They came into my office. The first one, and I put on purpose on my desk many books. The person start reading. At the end, the first person of the week say, "I think this book is so nice. Can I buy something of them?" I say, "No, you can take it for free." "So are you sure?" I can take the books. And the person say, "Okay, I want this, and this, because it's amazing." And the person took like four or five books. And I had another one before yesterday. Another client came, the same thing. And right out of the blue, start talking about God. This person say, she look at me and say, "Are you a pastor?" I say, no, I'm an accountant. I happen to have books here. How much cost the books?" People, if you listen to me, brothers and sisters, if people come to you and ask how much cost the book, what do you think? Are they interested or not?
Yeah.
So, and I say, "No, you can take as many as you wish." And the person took four books. My wife and Marina, I was Marina names and my wife, they went last week in front of a store here in New Park Road. You got surprised. I believe about 10 people, only one or two say no, right? A whole lot of say yes. Thank you. What are you waiting for to tell? And say, "Hey, the time that we're living now, we are walking in the wilderness. You know that? It's the wilderness time, like the Israelites, but we are going to the promised land." I know that sounds a little, I don't know, Pentecostal? Or I saw another preacher doing it, but when I was thinking straight, I was reading more and more the Bible is saying, no, we don't have too much time to spare. I don't know if you are with me, but I see things around, and I'm reading, listening, watching. I don't know how long we have. And I don't refer only to the disasters, like to the volcanoes or earthquake or tornado, because it seems for America, we're okay with that, right? Every year we have the, how they call in the South, the tornado season. We have, looks like, oh no, okay, this is coming. When you see change in the spiritual world, political world, scientific world, you need to start to think, say, hey, wait a minute, there's something there that was not in place. I have sometimes funny with my daughters, my two of them. I like some sort of the technology, but most of the time I'm not good. There's some like Twitter, Instagram, all this stuff. I have no clue how it works. And I Anyways, when I mentioned to this, sometimes they come, no, Papa, you need to do this and this. They come in the telephone, I'm just looking at somebody, all those stuff. But I found one day somebody coming to an old man and say, hey, you don't know to use the technology. And the person says, my friend, we are the one that created the technology. We're talking about what the name of the guy, Steve Jobs, one of the examples. Our generation is the generation, at least my generation, I was born in a place without electricity. We had lamps there. Of course, I was 3 years old and I remember the place I was born in, a farm. And we came to a place, to a situation that our world, our image is going in the same moment everywhere. And here we are in the most difficult times of our lives. False prophets, tons of them. We know that some people are even praying without mentioning God's name. We have a national day of prayer, right? In US, we have a national day of prayer. The first time that I saw somebody praying without using God's name, I said, how? And was kind of awkward, but yeah, I heard the person, to whom are you praying? To whom? Then we have in the political world is a chaos. Everywhere, not only here, but every country, they have some situation, they say, we don't know what to do. They come to their leaders and they say, tell us what to do. They say, oh no, you do this, but 2 months later, no, you have to do this. Then we have riots, then we have people going to the streets. It's a confusion. But Jesus Christ say, that's what's going to happen. There will be, at the end, and Jesus Christ keep describing the way that would be at the end. And let's go to verse 22. This is important to us. If those days had not been cut short, what going to happen? No one would survive. Did you ever think about what if a Holy Spirit would leave the earth, go to heaven, and leave the earth at his home? What do you think is going to happen? How many people would be able to stand? The Christian would be the first one to disappear. But after that, if those days would not be short, no one would survive. But for the sake of the elect, those days will be shortened. Do you know why earth is not destroyed yet? Because God has a people here. Still, he has a people. Sometimes we may think, oh, maybe I'm alone believing on that. But I always quote with Chuck saying the class. There are 7,000 there, that was the Bible said. There are another people out there thinking the same way, that this world cannot last long. And when I hear secular people say this situation cannot last long, and I say, well, it's time for me to wake up. What am I doing? If somebody that does not believe in God is saying something like this, what should I say? What should I say? And here, the Jesus counseling. Let's go to verse 36.
Okay?
Matthew 24. About that day hour, no one knows. Not even the angels in heaven are the Son, but only the Father. Now, 37. This verse everybody knows by heart. No one believed in God. I used to think of that. And I say, well, 8 people there are. The kids came because of Noah. The wife came, she was with him, but basically just that people. That's it. Do you think only them believe in God? And no. More people believe in God. Not all of them were idolaters. Not all of them were worshiping idols. Many people they, but Noah was a fanatic. Noah was going to say, hey, it's going to rain. It will be a destruction. People, let's build boats. Let's build arks. And then we'll be saved. But the people say, I believe the very first one that say to Lord, Lord, you are not right, I think we're the believers. Mm-hmm. And say, no, how long will it take? In 1 week, maybe? So I don't know. No, I didn't know. And then past 1 week, two, a month, a year, and there was no one. 120 years say the same absolute thing and say, man, forget about, because this is not going to happen. And how many people were saved in the ark? And the whole world perished. Even people that they said with their mouth, they believed in God, they perished. Not just unbelievers, not just the secular people. My concern today, brothers and sisters, for us to not fail in the same trap, like in Noah's day, or like in the Israelites. Because remember what I say to Israelites, if you read the story, we have a tendency to skip, leave Egypt, settle in Canaan. No, was 40 years in the wilderness. How many people die in the wilderness? The whole generation of adult people, they all perish. I will say the whole generation was not saved. They never entered. And from adult point of view, only two people got there. So here we are in a group of people in our church, in our community. And the question remains, if Jesus Christ would come out today, the Son of Man would come today, would he find faith here in our middle? A faith that will overcome mountains, the Bible says. A faith that would allow him to work in our hearts, in our minds. A faith that would allow him to put his righteousness on us. A faith that would allow him to put his character on us, because it's the only way to get the promised land or the new Canaan. And Jesus advises us, he warns us, the verse 38, for in the days before the flood, people are eating and drinking. They are partying until the day that Noah entered the ark. They knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them away. Listen to this, this is a warning. How it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. So how will we respond to that? How we will respond to this warning? Is a time for plan ahead for 5, 10, 20 years? I would say yes, I would like to spend my next 5 years in heaven. If possible. That should be a plan to say, hey, my eyes, my mind, my heart upon Jesus, and that's my plan. My plan is to live according to his will. That should be the plan. And the last verse that I want to read with you this morning is the Bible verse that was right there, the verse 42. Therefore, brothers and sisters, new and those who are watching us, those from another place, keep watch. Because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. Keep watch. Be ready with the sandal on your feet, belt on your waist, and ready to move. Because the call is coming, and it's soon. Jesus Christ is coming soon. I know that sounds like repeating for many, many years we're repeating the message, but never was so soon like now. That's what I say about the title of my message today. It is the beginning of the end. Let's be ready. Amen. Let's sing. The closing hymn will be 5, 6, 7. 5, 6, 7. Please stand as we sing. before we pray, I just want to make an invitation for, we have practice, rehearsal today.
Yes, absolutely.
And those who will participate can stay a little longer. Let's close our eyes. Heavenly Father, thank you so much, Lord, for blessings, for all care. Lord, we know that we are walking now in the wilderness. We are waiting for the promised land, but we want to be ready. Maybe the journey will be long or short, but we want to be with you, Lord. Please help us to walk according to your way. Stay with us, stay with every family, and they go back home, and those who are watching us from home, Lord. Be a blessing to all of them. We want to be in your presence. We want to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.